Very good afternoon to all of you. Today, on behalf of College of Paramedical Science, Tirthankar Mahavir University, I welcome you all faculty to this webinar, that is Early Refractive Development, 21st June 2021. Our honorable chief guest, Mr. Gopi Vankudre sir, honorable respected vice principal, Dr. Navneet sir, our departmental head, Mr. Rakesh Yadav, and all distinguished faculty members. It gives me a warm welcome for everyone present in the interest of the entire College of Paramedical Science family. Our team organizes our webinar consistently for webinar for students to gain information and to be effectively associated with college. Along with studying in this university, it is very important to have webinar as well. Through this webinar, student will upgrade and update their knowledge and skill. I ensure the webinar, this webinar will be beneficial and the next few hours will be enjoyable and fruitful for everyone of you. Now I am going to introduce our today's international guest lecturer, Mr. Gopi sir. He has an excellent academic background. He has interested in ocular and pedagogical research. He received best ongoing student award for the qualification of master in optometry program with distinction and gold medal, received fellow of International Association of Contact Lens Educators Awards in 2011. He successfully led GKB Private Limited Organization Corporate Mission Vision Program. He received the Best Optometrist Award for the year 2005. He is also member of core group developing Indian entry-level optometry competency standard. He awarded with university research grant and published in prestigious national and international peer review journal. Currently his research activities, barriers to recommended care among age-related macular degeneration patient with different provinces, Oman, a qualitative study. He has experience as an assistant professor in Bharti Vidyapeeth School of Optometry Medical College. Now he is an associate professor in College of Health Science School of Optometry, University of Burami, Oman. So thank you, sir. Now I request you, Gopi sir, to take this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pinaki sir, for such a nice introduction. And I should first thank you, Rakesh sir, as well as Navneet sir, for giving me this platform to interact with all our students. And definitely, I will enjoy with this interaction with the students as well. So let me share the screen first. I think Pinaki sir, you will have to.
Rakesh sir, please share the screen. Allow sir to share the screen.
Rakesh sir, for sharing the screen. And now in this today's presentation, we will discuss about what are the early developments, early refractive developments when the child is born till the adulthood, as well as we will just brief about some of the points which are at the later stages, what are the changes which are happening. So we will go through the presentation, we will discuss various points. So if you have any questions in between or you want to ask something, you can definitely ask in between or you want to ask later on, that is still fine. Okay, so let us start with a very famous dialogue from the three idiots. That is, we know virus, when the child is born, the virus asks the newborn, what do you want to become? Tujhe jo banna hai ban. But as an optometrist, do we have this liberty to ask a newborn, jo tujhe banna hai ban, myopic ban, hyperopic ban, ya emmetropic ban? Do we have this opportunity? Absolutely not, right? So it is a big no, that no, you cannot. We are actually stubborn that you should become an emmetropic. So that is why this concept of what are the changes which are happening in the early stages of life in refraction are important for us to understand. So at the end of this session, I hope we should be able to understand what is emmetropization. What are the different refractive errors distribution among the children as well as in the newborn population? And what are the various factors which are affecting the emmetropization? We will also try to understand the different concepts which is related to central focus as well as the peripheral defocus, and which carries a key role in development of the eye. We will also try to understand the management of different refractive errors at the early stages. So we are not going into the details of it because our topic is about the early refractive development, but we'll just try to understand what type of management would be beneficial if the eye has to emmetropize very well. So first of all, let us go to the point that why to define how the refraction Let me just take it as laser pointer here. Yeah. So why to define how refraction develops from the birth all the way into adulthood? What is the necessity? Okay, let it grow what it is. But it is important to define how the refraction is developing so that we understand the relevance of emmetropization. We already know why emmetropization is important. And if the emmetropization is not happening, what are the various factors which are responsible for causing the refractive errors? And this, okay, the refractive errors are causing, and okay, no problem, we will give the spectacle lenses to the patient and then he is fine. But it is not so simple. As we know that there are also the associated consequences with such type of etiologic refractive or such type of refractive error. For example, in the case of myopia, we do get myopic degenerations, maculopathy, or the retinal detachment, which causes the irreversible changes. So it is important for us to not to have ametropia and have emmetropia. So what is emmetropization? Like during the first phase or early phase of our study, we tried to understand, oh, emmetropization is same as emmetropia. We know that emmetropia we define when the parallel rays of light, when eyes are unaccommodated, focus on the retina. But emmetropization, can we say as the same thing? It is not. It is emmetropization. It is the eye is actually matching with the optical power to its axial length. For example, we know that normal axial length is 24 millimeter and the normal eye power is 60 dapter. If the axial length is more than 24 millimeter, the refractive power should be lesser so as to focus the rays on the retina and vice versa. So eye is adjusting itself to its axial length so that the rays will be focusing on the retina, and this process we call it as emmetropization. When this emmetropization is successful, the eye will become emmetropic and it will avoid becoming ametropic like hypermetropia, myopia, or astigmatism, and it will avoid any further consequences. So, as I mentioned, emmetropia is no refractive error, no correction required for distance. But emmetropization is looking at especially the range that is starting from minus 0.5 diopter of myopia to 1 diopter of hypermetropia. So as the child is developing or the eye grows, if the emmetropization is achieved successfully, that means the refractive status of the eye should be between minus 0.5 to plus 1 diopter. So you can see it is definitely not a case of a plus, just a plano lens in front of the eye or the no lens required. Still we say that, okay, emmetropization has been achieved successfully. Along with these spherical refractive errors, even the small amount of astigmatism can also be considered considered within the acceptable range. So please, it is important for us to understand emmetropization does not mean that the patient should have only plano refractive, plano power. It is the range between minus 0.5 to 1 diopter. Let's take it to this side. Okay. So basically, many researchers categorize the development of refraction in two groups. One is the development that is happening up to the age of 6 years, and the development that is happening after 6 years. So as the child is born, we will be able to see the different kinds of refractive errors or the refractive status among this population. It will vary from emmetropia, mostly hypermetropia, and very small percentage of the neonate population with myopia. But later on, this trend changes. So we see a wide refractive error range or refractive status range among the neonate. So this range of refraction is typically showing the Gaussian pattern. Can anybody tell me what is the Gaussian pattern? Anybody would like to? What is a Gaussian pattern? Many of the researcher, many books will say that it is a Gaussian pattern. Okay, so the Gaussian pattern is nothing but a very simple thing is, as you can see the graph here, look at the laser pointer on the screen, or see the graph here. For both the lines on the graph, you can see this red line or this blue line. The graph is distributed equally towards its mean values. Let me take the pen from here. Yeah. If we take this, or let me take for the blue one. See, this is the mean value, which is around 1 to 2 diopter. So if this is the mean value, you see the population, which is less than 2 diopter, that is, you can see it is myopic here, and population, which is more than 2 diopter, the amount is 50% here and 50% on the other side. When we have such distribution, we call it as the normal distribution, or we call it as a bell curve, or we call it as a Gaussian pattern. In this picture also, we are able to see the Gaussian pattern. So 50% of the values are here and 50% of the values are here. Please consider this line to be there in the center. So this is still a Gaussian pattern, but what you can see is this blue line is indicating for the newborn. And for the newborn, you can see the range of refractive error. It is from minus 7 to plus 9 diopter. So you can see a very high amount of myopia to a very high amount of hypermetropia. But the mean is situated near towards 1 or 2 diopter of hypermetropia. What does it mean? Is the neonates have got around 2 diopter of hypermetropia. Along with having this particular hypermetropia, the neonates can also have slight amount of toricity. So this amount of toricity, what the neonates can have, is around 2 diopter of astigmatism. So this corneal toricity, which is 2 diopter of astigmatism, is of the nature of against the rule astigmatism. So what is against the rule astigmatism? In which the horizontal curvature of the cornea is steeper than the vertical curvature of the cornea. So this astigmatism or this hyperopia, which is quite common among the newborn, however, you can also see the other types of within the population. Now, about these 2 diopter of against the rule astigmatism, many researchers believe that it is not real astigmatism, it is an artifact. Artifact means which is something which is artificial, which is not real. It could be because of the large angle lambda. Now, what is the angle lambda? Is we know about the axis and the angles of the eye. So the angle lambda is nothing but which is present between the papillary axis and the line of sight, that we reflect it as the angle lambda. So now we should have a clear idea about neonates, that in neonates the refractive error distribution is from two diopter, mainly in the mean of two diopter, but it is varying in the range from myopia to hypermetropia, so the standard deviation is much more higher. Now let us come to the within the first year, what is going to happen. So within the first year, the major development of the eyeball is happening within the first year. Now what is going to change within the first year? There will be changes in the corneal curvature, there will be changes in the axial length, as well as there will be the changes in the lens power. So the corneal curvature, as we said before, that against the rule astigmatism is quite common in newborn, which will try shifting towards with the rule astigmatism. Even the axial length will start growing. The normal axial length at the newborn, for the newborn is around 17.5 millimeter, it will start growing. And the lens power will also change. The key important point we have to consider here is, look at the graph of the 6 to 8 years old. And this graph, you can see it is highly steeper. That means you can see the mean is coming towards zero, and this peripheral range is coming closer and closer. That means the range of refractive error is getting towards emmetropia. So the process of emmetropization is happening from the newborn to this particular age group, which is of 6 to 8 years of age. So as the mostly the development is occurring by the age of 6, that is why most of the researchers will consider this age as a comparative factor. Okay. Now look at the age-wise distribution of refraction. So the age-wise distribution of refraction, again you can see this is one of the benchmark studies which is done in 2005. And this is another study which is by Ingram, which was done in 1979. The reason we have taken here is we are comparing as per the age, how the refraction is changing. See here, it is 3 months, this is 9 months, this is 1 year old, and this is three year old. So look at the first graph. You can see all the graph are showing the Gaussian distribution, that is a normal distribution, also called as a bell curve. But when you consider 3 month child or the 3 month children population, most of the values are concentrated towards two diopter of hypermetropia. At the age of 9 months, this mean of two diopter is shifting towards emmetropia. Now it is, you can see it is shifting to around 1 to 1.5 diopter of hypermetropia. Even you can see this graph is getting elevated slowly and slowly. At the third point, that is 1 year old, see the graph is more towards emmetropia. However, the amount of hypermetropia is still higher. And when the child is 3 years old, see, the standard deviation is reducing for this particular refractive errors. And you can see this graph is called, this graph is much more steeper. And this graph, we call it as leptokurtic curve. So as per the age-wise distribution of refraction, first, there is a progressive shift from 2 diopter to 0.75 diopter. Second, there is a reduction in the standard deviation. As the standard deviation, the range is reducing, that is why the graph is getting steeper and steeper. And then it is getting positively skewed distribution. Now, what is positively skewed distribution is if we put a line here, you can see the graph is showing the bell curve, but it is more towards the hyperopic side and less towards the myopic side. And that is why it is still showing a positively skewed distribution. Okay, you can ask me any doubts if you have in between. So what are the stages of the axial length growth? So when the eyeball is growing, there is a reduction in hypermetropia which is going to happen. When there is a reduction in hypermetropia, it is mainly because of the axial length growth. Yes, the other ocular parameters are also changing, such as corneal curvature or the anatomical lens. But why there is a main reduction in hypermetropia is because of the axial length is growing. If we consider at birth, the axial length is around 17 millimeter, and by the end of 2.5 year, that is about 30 months, the axial length is growing up to 22.5 millimeter. So there is a 5.5 millimeter increase in the axial length by 2.5 years. And when it is reaching the adulthood, you can see it is starting from 22.5, it is reaching to 24 millimeters. So you can understand after this development of after 2.5 years, when it is reaching to adulthood, there is only a change of 1.5 millimeters. So there is a very small change which is happening in a later life, but the major change is happening at this particular stage. So we have seen about the refractive error development, that is before 6 years. And now we will look at what is the refractive error development, that is after the 6 years of age. Now this is quite contradicting, or this is quite different in different population. For example, you can see in the picture, you can see that the Australian population continue to grow with the emetropization, whereas the European population, also called as Caucasian population, has got the lower levels of myopia and hypermetropia. But here I have shown the typical picture which is presenting for the Japanese population, in which there is a rise in myopia from 49.3% to 65.6%. So you can see that there is an increase in the amount of myopia from this period to this period. And this myopia increase is specifically due to the increase in the axial length. So the point to be noted is this is 6 years. After 6 years also, the axial length is increasing. So you might be, oh, what is the concern? Concern is there because this axial length can cause damage to the retina. And that is the reason we are very much focusing on whether the emetropization is occurring properly or not. Even in the Asian population, even in Indian population, myopia prevalence is getting higher and higher. So as our topic is about early refractive developments, we are mainly focusing on this particular point, that is after 6 years up to certain period, as well as before 6 years. But just to give you a hint of what are the other refractive changes which are happening in the later on life, that is the optical power of the lens changes more compared to its axial length. So it stops growing unless and until you can see certain population, something like this. The lens continues to grow with the changes in the refractive index. We know that with the physiological changes in the lens, the refractive index of the lens will increase, or depending on what are the physiological changes which are happening. And mostly whenever there is a development of the cataract, there is more likely to be a myopic change for the lenses. So even though the lens is growing throughout the life, it acts like a balancing rule. It tries to maintain the refraction. However, due to cataract, there might be a shift towards the myopic side. Look at this another study, which was done among the Chinese population. These children, when they were in the age of 3 to 6 years, they were done refracted and the spherical equivalent was calculated. The spherical equivalent is nothing but the spherical plus half of the cylinder. Generally for our studies, when we want to understand how much is the magnitude of refractive error, it is not possible to take the spherical separately, cylinder separately, and then compare. That is why for comparison purpose, in research we use the spherical equivalent to understand how much is the change. So this spherical equivalent is reflecting on the x-axis, and you can see the number of subjects on the y-axis. And this refraction, which was done in 1995, among the same students when they were of 3 to 6 years of age, which is shown by the black dots, you can see they were more towards emmetropic. The graph is much more steeper here, more towards planocyte. But when the same students were refracted after 5 years, this graph is changed and it is shifting towards the myopic side. So there is a big concern that if there is a change within the 5 years among this population, that is when the refractive development was supposed to be completed, even after 5 years, you can see that there is a myopic shift among this particular population. And that is a matter of concern. So for some ethnic population, myopia is not a chance. For myopia is like a rule. So Chinese is one of the population wherein which the myopia is a rule. There is no exception to it. So in overall, if we see that what are the ocular changes which are happening at birth, the axial length was around 17 millimeter. At adulthood, it will be 23 to 24 millimeter. The mean keratometry is, look at this, is how much steeper it is at birth. It is 56 diopter. And in the adulthood, it is around 43 diopter. The lens power also at birth is around 45 diopter, which is reducing to 24 diopter at the adulthood. So these are the changes which are happening through the changes in the refraction in our eye. Apart from the refractive changes, it is also the placement of the optical elements. And one of the things which we look at is the how much is the anterior chamber depth which is changing in different populations. So in this particular chart, you can see 5 different ethnicities: white, Native American, reflecting by N, Hispanics, Asians by A, and African American. So let us say A is here, which is of our main concern, Asians, and W, white, let us see the extremes, and let us see this B, the black Africans, or you can say the Native Americans, because Native Americans and A are going almost together. On the y-axis, you are able to see anterior chamber depth, and on the x-axis, you are able to see age in years. So the age, at the age 6, anterior chamber depth is measured at different population, and this is measured for the different age groups for different ethnicities. Now, which ethnic group has got a higher anterior chamber depth from the beginning. Look at this. So this white ethnic group already has the higher or the bigger anterior chamber depth, and it will increase further. Whereas when you see for the Asian population or the Native American population, this anterior chamber depth is already smaller compared to the other population. Here there is some exception, but you can see that this Black Americans, they have the smaller anterior chamber depth, which is around 3.4 millimeter, but it will grow further till the age of 14. Say, for example, it is 3.60. However, Asian population, it is around 3.45, which is already lesser, and it grows very little. So the depth does not increase much. And you know what is the consequences of if the anterior chamber depth is more smaller, is it can lead to angle closure glaucoma. So these communities, that is Asians or North Americans, are at a higher risk of having angle closure glaucoma compared to the population of whites. Now look at the other factor, which is about corneal toricity. We discussed that corneal toricity will change from birth to certain age, and we know that it is a two amount, the corneal toricity is around 2 diopter against the rule astigmatism. But now what we are comparing in this chart is we are comparing the corneal toricity in different ethnicities in age-wise manner. So here, which group has got this less amount of corneal toricity is again, you see, whites have got very small amount of corneal toricity, and the Native Americans have got a large amount of corneal toricity. Asians are in between, so there is no problem. Asians are just a moderate here. This is an important consideration. The refractive error as per the different ethnicities. So here, again, we have calculated the spherical equivalent. Spherical equivalent, we know that we are going to understand, compare the magnitude of refractive error in different populations. We are considering our favorite populations here. And for the Asian group, already this Asian group at the age of 6, it is towards emetropia, which is around a very small amount of refractive error or hyperopia. This age group is having. But later on, as the age increases, it is, you can see that there is a more shift towards the myopic side. So you might be happy here, oh, there is no refractive error, but it is not the case. You can see that if there is a low amount of refractive error here, the chance that they will be getting it myopia in the later on stages. That is an important consideration. Whereas if you see other people, other ethnicities, they have a 1 diopter of hypermetropia, and by the age 14, they're almost getting emetropic. So who is at a higher risk of getting myopia is the Asian population. They are at a higher risk of getting myopia. So what are the factors which are affecting the normal developmental process? So the factors could be something which we can control. We will call it as modifiable risk factors, and something which we cannot control, which are non-modifiable risk factors. For example, monozygotic twins, which is out of our hand. So here, this monozygotic twins are expected to have the same refractive error. So what is monozygotic is they are they are coming from the same ovum, that is monozygotic twins, whereas the hereditary of myopia, in which if the parent has myopia, there is a chances or the higher risk that their children will have myopia, and it is also vice versa. If the child has myopia, there is a likely chance that his parent are myopic. Also, there are other factors which I said is about modifiable risk factors, such as environmental factors. So what are the modifiable risk factors? Suppose if we ask our child to go and play outdoors, the risk of getting myopia is lesser. So such modifiable risk factors, we will call it as the environmental factors. Nowadays, with the help of due to the exposure to gadgets mostly, and due to the educational pressure mostly, kids are expected to do the near activity a lot, and they are fascinated towards the gadgets. So this is further leading to the development or early changes in the refractive error. So I am not really saying that I am not focusing on myopia, but I am saying it is affecting the normal emetropization process. So here, these are the factors which are something which is we can control, something which we can manage. For example, if we observe a child who has got an accommodative lag, it is the role of optometrist to identify it at an early stage and to give the managerial option. Now, what is accommodative lag? Now, accommodative lag is something which is, as the patient has to see for the near clearly, the eye has to accommodate. But if the amount of accommodation what it is, what the child is exerting, is lesser than what is required, you can see the focus is behind. And this accommodative lag gives a stimulus to the retina and to the brain for the further development of the eye here, so as to get emetropic, and ultimately when this eyeball is growing, it is the axial length is growing, it can further lead to myopia. So the refractive distribution that is arising from two different conflicting tendencies. So we can say that why there is a difference in the refractive distribution. Some are getting emmetropic, some are getting refractive error. So why there is a distribution among this refractive status? Now this is coming from two different tendencies. One tendency is there is a mechanism which is present in the body, in the eye, that is controlling the eye growth during the infancy, so as to bring the proper refraction and bring the stage of emetropia, or at least emetropization is properly achieved. So we are not looking at everybody has to have the plano correction. We are looking at a range of -0.5 to +1 diopter. There is a second mechanism, that there is a tendency of the people or the human population who are developing myopia during their later childhood or into adulthood. So what is that? Is that these people, what we have seen in Chinese population or in Chinese population or in the Japanese population, we can see that there is a development of myopia. So there is a conflicting tendencies, and these are the two tendencies. So let us see what are the responsible factors which are hindering the refractive development. Before going on to the core of the basic components which we will look at, the factors, Let us have an overview of what is the biochemistry behind this emetropization. Now Nirit sir will be able to really go into the depth of what is the biochemistry involved into this emetropization. But I will just give you a few details about what is the biochemistry of emetropization and myopia. So basically, the retinal signals which are providing the visual signals to the brain are important for the growth of myopia. There are two different kinds of focuses. One is the hyperopic defocus and the other one is the myopic defocus. I will talk about this in detail in the upcoming slides. I'm just giving you an overview here. So these signals, how the image is forming on the retina, in front of retina or behind the retina, the eye is trying to adjust itself, so that we are calling it as visually regulated eye growth. The second one, or the important point, is about retinal dopamine. So dopaminergic system, which is present in the eye, it carries a big role as a neuromodulator role in the light adaptation. It is also important for the retinal diurnal rhythms. So this dopamine, as we say that the children has to go out, it has to do with the dopamine levels that is also moderating the growth of the eyeball. But it is not only the dopamine, it is also the other nanomines which are also responsible for modulating the eye growth, such as melatonin or serotonin. So all these factors has to be considered when we are considering the point of emetropization. Now, apart from this amines, an amino acid which is also called as VIP, that is influenced by the form deprivation, and that is observed not only in human subject, it is observed in the chick and the primate studies. So the very recent studies that this research was published in around 2019, that what they are trying to say is, or what they stated is, that the form deprivation which is happening, form deprivation is nothing but where the eye is getting the stimulus, light stimulus, but the eye is not getting the stimulus for the shape or the line clearly. That is, we call it as form deprivation. Let me say what is a form deprivation. A very simple term is, if you are emetropic and I put a plus 4 diopter lens in front of the eye, you are still sensing the light, but the object is not clear. So in such conditions, this particular peptide is influenced and is thought to be responsible for the emetropization. Another interesting point, which is about melanopsin, which is not involved in the phototransduction process as like rhodopsin, but it is also sensitive to light. So this melanopsin is not actually forming the is not actually responsible for the image formation, but is responsible for the circadian rhythms. And the other important point, which is related to the eye growth, is glucagon and insulin. We know their roles in modulating the blood sugar levels, or their opposite roles in modulating the blood sugar levels. But in eye growth, this insulin is actually opposing the glucagon for supporting the ocular growth. So this is quite something which is interesting related to the biochemistry about emetropization or the development of myopia. So the further research is towards this circadian rhythm and for the biochemistry towards the development of, or for the emetropization process. So now, as I have discussed all these points which are related to the biochemistry, I'm elaborating it further with this particular slides, that is deprivation. Deprive means you don't give something to someone. So what we are not giving is we are either not giving the light to the eye, that is, you will call it as stimulus deprivation. There is no stimulus to the eye, stimulus deprivation, or you are giving the light, but the object, you are not making it clear for the patient. So, for example, if I put a partial occluder in front of your eye, how the image you will be able to see is completely diffused. You are not able to identify it clearly. That is nothing but the form deprivation. So you can see on the slide on your left, that is deprivation, that is a form deprivation. And this form deprivation we have done. There are two groups. One group, which is the deprived eye, which is shown with the black dots. And the other group, which is the control eye, where we have not given any kind of diffuser. This side is showing the strongest diffuser, and this side is showing it is an intermediate diffuser. So in this research, there are two different types of diffusers used. This is the stronger diffuser, and this is the intermediate diffuser. What the point we are interested in is, look at the amount of ametropia which is developing in this. Where we have given a stronger diffuser, the amount of ametropia is very much higher compared to the group which we have not given any kind of diffuser. Now here, what do you mean by control group? Control group is something which we have either provided the traditional intervention or no intervention. So this control group is, if the eye is already emetropic, no need of giving any glasses. So this one is, we have not given any kind of diffuser. And here we have given a kind of diffuser. So this one is definitely not in the human eye. We have done it with the animal eye models. And all these animal eye models or animal eye research are used to understand the mechanism of emetropization. If you try to see with the vitreous chamber depth, there is not a significant difference. But with the diffuser, the stronger diffuser, there is a change in ametropia. The ametropia is much more higher. And with the intermediate diffuser, this amount of ametropia, there is a very small change or compared to the control group. Now, let us come to the stimulus deprivation. There are various studies which were done among animals in which the eye of the same monkey, for one eye, it was sutured, the eyelids were sutured, and the other eye was kept normal. So the monkey who is expected to have the normal refractive error as that of the other infant monkeys, one eye was sutured and the other eye was not sutured. And they tried to understand how much is the change in the refractive error which is happening over the time. So that is stimulus deprivation. That is, you're already suturing the eye with the, you're already closing the eyelids with sutures. So that is stimulus deprivation. Here also you can see that there is a case of stimulus deprivation here. Because of the ptosis, the person is not, the child is not able to see. So in such cases, what is observed, if untreated, there is a chance that the eyeball growth will be much more longer compared to the other normal eye, the same person. But one eyeball growth is more compared to the other eye. So there is a kind of signal which is provided from the retina to brain that something is necessary to be done, and there is a growth which is happening, abnormal growth which is happening. So first one which we discussed is about the deprivation and poses the risk of axial length increase. Now, let us look at this interesting one, which is about the optically induced defocus. So what do you mean by optically induced defocus is, if you don't put any lens, the rays are very nicely focusing on the retina. That means they're absolutely fine. There is no problem. So if you are emmetropic and I don't put any lens, the rays are focusing very nicely on the retina. But if I put a minus lens in front of you, the rays will be focusing behind the retina. Correct? So what you have created is, you have created a hyperopic defocus. And if I put a plus lens in front of an emmetropic eye, the rays will be focusing in front of the retina. That is, you're optically inducing myopia by putting a plus lens, and you're optically inducing hypermetropia by putting minus lens. So the minus lens is creating a hyperopic defocus, and the plus lens is creating a myopic defocus. So you might be wondering, oh, why it is to be done? Why to defocus it? So it is not done in the human eyes, again, because we want to understand that, is this focus really important for understanding or for the eye growth? So what they did is, they took the normal infant monkeys and they introduced the optical defocus, either the hyperopic defocus or the myopic defocus, by putting plus or minus lens in front of the infant monkeys. And then they observed these monkeys over the 100 days period. And what is the change in their refraction or the axial length they observed over a period? So look at this. They have taken 6 monkeys. So this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 monkeys. So these 6 monkeys, look at the first monkey. This monkey already has got a hyperopic power, that is around 4 diopter. This monkey already has got a hyperopic power of around hyperopic status of around 6 diopter. This monkey also has got hyperopic status of around 3 diopter. And this monkey also has got 6 diopter of hypermetropia. This monkey has 4 diopter of hypermetropia, and this monkey has got around 6 diopter of hypermetropia. So we have taken all monkeys here. And now in front of this monkey who has already 4 diopter of hypermetropia, we have induced plus 9 diopter lens in front of this monkey's eye. And we have induced this not only for a temporary purpose, this is throughout the experiment we have induced. And when we wanted to do refraction, only that time the spectacles or the glasses are removed. We have done the refraction and kept the plus 9 lens once again in front of the eyes. And we tried to observe what is happening from the day 1 to the 100 day. You can see here 0 to 100. So after 100, by the 100 days, how much is the change in refraction that is happening in this monkey? After 100 days, how much is the change which is happening in this monkey, this monkey, this, and this, we are trying to observe. So you can see that this monkey, we put a plus lens, this monkey where we put a plus 6 diopter lens, so plus 9 is going to make much more myopic, plus 9 is going to make much more myopic defocus. So this diopter, the monkey already had the refractive error of around plus 6, at the end of 6, plus 6 dash, that means there was no change in its axial length or no change in the refractive status. This plus 3 diopter we had kept in front of the monkey's eye, and this monkey had his own refractive error of plus 6. So that means even after accommodation, the person of this monkey, you can see that the shift from hypermetropia towards myopia, towards metropia. So this green line able to see is we are expecting them to be in after 100 days. So it is coming over here. Even the control monkey, as we did not put any correction for the patient, however, it was a placebo that was, we gave only the plano lens for this monkey, and you can see it is, that refraction is still going in the expected range. But now the interesting point, see here, that is monkey to whom we gave minus 3 diopter and to whom we gave minus 6 diopter, look at them, what is happening. They started with around 4 diopter of hypermetropia or 6 diopter of hypermetropia. But if you see, after 100 days, they have developed myopia. Ultimately, what I want to say is, this minus 3 or this minus 6 lens in front of these eyes have created a hyperopic defocus, and this hyperopic defocus are the reason of getting myopia. So the hyperopic defocus is considered to be one of the culprit of developing myopia. Again, I'm not saying about myopia, I'm saying about early refractive changes. So ultimately, in children, if there is a hyperopic defocus, ultimately the refractive emetropization process or early refractive changes will not be normal. So it is important for us to consider the manage the patient at an early age. So we have seen one component, which is deprivation, stimulus deprivation or form deprivation. We have seen other component, which is optically induced defocus. And now let us see the role of accommodation. We already said something about the accommodative lag before. So the scientist Engram and Muthi et al., what they tried to do is they tried to give the correction to cover this accommodative lag. They tried to give, or they gave the near addition to these children. So Muthi et al. Gave 2 diopter addition to these children, and they were trying to see whether the emetropization is coming within the normal limit. And it was possible they were able to achieve the emetropization only in cases of esophoria. So later on, as it was only in the cases of esophoria, Jiang et al., they provided additions for with the reduced additions, so as to benefit even with the children who have got less amount of esophoria. So these studies indicate that correcting the accommodative lag or maintaining the appropriate accommodative levels are benefiting for the proper emetropization process. We know the role of dopamine and as an indicator, that is channeling for the eye growth. It is important for us to recommend outdoor activities for children. As you can see in this graph, myopic children, how much time they are spending outdoors, that is explained by the light exposure, that is lux, and how much time the non-myopic children are spending outdoors, which is shown by the blue line. So the myopic children, as expected, are observed to spend lesser time outdoors because you can see the light exposure is much more lesser. Whereas the light exposure among the for the non-myopic children is much more higher. In this peak range, which is showing about in a daylight, we get around 1800 lux exposure. So it is important for us to properly secrete the dopamine, to properly have the dopamine levels. It is outdoor activities are a must and we should be recommending it. Initially, it was thought that whether the very close work is responsible for causing myopia, but it is considered now it is not the near activity, it is the less of outdoor activities as the main culprit. Now, if you have two children, one has got a parental history of myopia and the other one do not have the parental history of myopia. Now, both of these kids, if they are not involved in outdoor activities, the one who has parental history of myopia is at a higher risk of rapidly developing myopia compared to the other child. So it is history taking in such cases is much more important for the patient counseling. Now, I only told you about the hyperopic defocus before and the importance of myopic defocus. But now, in another study, we observe some contrasting observations. Like you can see here that these two graphs are showing under correction. So the children with myopic correction, we are trying to see that if they are fully corrected, how much is the change in refraction which is happening over the period. So this is one study and this is also the another study. So if the children are fully corrected fully corrected, even here it is fully corrected. But if we slightly undercorrect these children by around 0.75 diopter, it was thought that, okay, it will bring the myopic defocus. You can understand. If we fully correct, the rays will be on the retina. But if the child is myopic and we undercorrect, that means the rays will be focusing in front of retina, which is already myopic defocus. So we are trying to achieve the status of myopic defocus. So it was thought that if we undercorrect these children and bring it to the myopic defocus, then the progress of myopia will be much more lesser. But you can see in this particular graph that the myopia progression was much more higher even in the undercorrected population. So this was observed with the first one and it was thought, okay, maybe this 0.75 undercorrection is a very big amount of undercorrection. So let us undercorrect but slightly less. So these scientists, they undercorrected it by around 0.5 diopter instead of 0.75. They used a very slight undercorrection. But still, you can see the gap is reduced, but the amount of progression of myopia in these children are again more compared to the children who were fully corrected. Now, look at this particular factor, which is temporal integration of visual signals. What do you mean by temporal? Temporal means timely basis, integration of visual signals. As you can clearly see, see from the graph, there is an amount of ametropia on the y-axis and age in days around the x-axis. This minus 3 diopter is reflecting that again we are using monkeys and they are using minus lenses. We have kept a minus 3 diopter lens in front of their eyes, and we are exposing them only for some time in between, that is reflecting that the hours of the light cycles here. And there is a control group which is shown in the gray line. So what we try to do is it that continuous, or if we give a break in between? So we have given that, remove the glasses, minus three lenses, and ask them to have the unrestricted vision without glasses. And now, does it develop myopia or not? So yes, even in those cases, the myopia is developing compared to the group of monkeys who were not given any kind of optical defocus. So the main point is hyperopic defocus versus unrestricted vision. So initially it was thought, okay, hyperopic defocus, like we did, like we considered in our previous picture, is if you keep the lenses, minus lenses, continuously, it is going to create hyperopic defocus. So we know that, okay, it is going to cause myopia. But in this experiment, what they did is they created a hyperopic defocus. However, intermittently, they allowed to have the unrestricted vision that is shown by the green lines here. So they were without spectacles or without minus 3 optical defocus for some time in between, and they were trying to understand whether it will interfere or it will not interfere with the emmetropagation. So you can clearly see that yes, even though we have provided unrestricted vision for these monkeys, it is still giving, it is still hindering the emmetropagation process. Now, so far we have discussed about the optical defocus, where we were talking about only the central vision. We know that the rays after refraction are focusing on the fovea. So we know the role of central refraction. Okay, if it is hyperopic defocus, it is going to cause myopia. Then the thought was, is it only the central vision responsible and not the peripheral vision? Actually, our assumption goes like this. Okay, because the central vision has got a main role, it should be the one who should be deciding how the eyeball should grow. But it is not the case. So our previous assumption was that the fovea carries the main visual acuity or the highest visual acuity and should be responsible for the refractive development. But now look into this particular picture, that this eye, this zero, is representing the level of the fovea. So at zero position, how much is the amount of myopia this patient is having is around 2.5 diopter. And the refraction is not same in vertical and horizontal meridian. You can see this vertical plane, which is shown with the dotted line, and horizontal plane refraction, which is shown with the solid line. So as you go from the center to periphery, what is happening to myopia? From center to periphery, the amount of myopia is decreasing and decreasing. What does it mean? So refraction, the central refraction is different than the peripheral refraction. Even the temporal field is different than the mesial field. So the signal which is passed from the center to the brain is different than the signal which is passed from the periphery. So what they did is they tried to give a form deprivation in the peripheral portion for the monkeys and tried to understand whether the emmetropagation is affected or not. So the central vision is clear, but the peripheral vision is blurred. And in the patients, now you can imagine what is a peripheral defocus would be, that in the patients who has the peripheral defocus are observed to have the rapid axial length growth. Let me tell you by this particular example here. this is the retina, for example. Now, this retina is not perfectly spherical. Now, if this patient has got minus 2.5 diopter refractive error for the central retina, that is at fovea, so you place a minus 2.5 diopter lens in front of the eye, the rays are focusing on the retina. But you can see in this particular picture is centrally refractive error is minus 2.5. But if you go from center to periphery, the refractive error is not 2.5. It is less and less. So that means as the amount of ametropia is less and the refractive error which what we have given here is minus 2.5 and it is a spherical, it will form a spherical plane here and it will be behind the retina. So this image cell will be behind the retina, though the central rays are focusing on the retina, these rays will be focusing behind the retina. So the peripheral refraction is not the same as the central refraction. The point is, this signal is sent to the brain as the image is not, there is a hyperopic defocus. And when there is a hyperopic defocus, there is a signal from the brain for the growth of the eyeball. So that is the reason. For example, when we correct a myopic patient with spectacles, what we get is, we get an image cell. If it is fully corrected, we get an image cell which is behind the retina that causes hyperopic defocus in the periphery. I'm not saying in the center. Center, yes, it is absolutely fine on the fovea. I'm saying even if you have optimally corrected the patient for the central vision, in the periphery, it is causing hyperopic defocus. And when it is a hyperopic defocus, there is a signal for the extra growth. And that is what we want to avoid. Then you might be wondering, though, okay, then what should be given? Is ultimately, if we want to reduce the axial length growth or unnecessary growth, the image cell has to be in front of the retina. So the center, you can see it is on the retina, but the peripheral portion, it is in front of the retina, creating a myopic peripheral defocus. That is the reason we give bifocal contact lenses or even the orthokeratology lenses. They are producing such kind of thing rather than giving the spectacle lenses. So look at this one, which I was saying is the form deprived. The monkey was given a clear vision in the center, but he was given a form deprivation. Form deprivation means they will be able to sense the light, but the shape and the size of the object is not very clear. So because it is not clear, it will create the form deprivation, then it will try to have a different abnormal growth compared to the ametropization. Now, again, the curiosity, the next curiosity. Oh, is it that only the peripheral vision important, not the central vision? So what they did is they ablated the fovea, not of the human eye, okay? They ablated the fovea of the monkey with laser. So you can see this ablation with laser. So when they ablated it, the monkey definitely will not be able to see through the center, and only the peripheral refraction, it will be responsible to understand whether there is any different growth than the normal ametropization process. And in the picture, you can see that the growth of the eyeball is almost similar to that of the normal control monkeys, which are shown in the gray color. So the green or the red color is showing the treated eye, that is the ablated eye is shown by the red color. The other eye of the same monkey is called as a fellow eye, and the normal monkeys, the control monkeys with whom we did not apply the photo ablation procedure, all of them follow the same pattern. So this means more than the central refraction, peripheral refraction carries an important role in emmetropization. This is the OCT picture showing the treated eye, that is, we have done the ablation, we have burnt the fovea, and the other fellow eye is showing the normal layers of the retina. So now we know that impact of the peripheral vision in monkeys, photoablation of the fovea, that is the central region, does not affect with emmetropization, does not prevent the recovery of the induced refractive error, does not prevent form deprivation, or does not prevent the compensation for the optical defocus. So what you will rate more? The peripheral refraction is more important, or the central refraction is more important? So in this case, the peripheral refraction will be much more important. So ultimately, what are the take-home messages? Is we have to consider the treatment for these patients at an early age. We have to check whether the normal emmetropization is happening. If you give minus lenses to a kid, he will be happy, he can see clearly, but your role does not stop there. Myopia prevalence is getting larger and larger. By the 2050, half of the population of the world is expected to get myopic, and it will be your mainly practice. So to avoid this, we have to have a concern that it should not grow. Sometimes it would be, if you look at the commercial aspects, myopia, okay, the refractive error, it is a boon, or it will be encouraging for optometrists, for ophthalmologists, but it is a bad thing for the considering the consequences such as maculopathy or any other retinal degeneration. So evaluating the accommodative level at an early stage, consider the peripheral refraction, and look at what are the modalities that you can give to your patient if it is a peripheral defocus or peripheral hyperopic defocus. As I mentioned, if you give spectacles, there is a limit for the peripheral to control the peripheral defocus. There are certain lenses which are coming, but however, it is not come. I don't think it is still in practice with the Indian scenario. But there are lenses which are made by Hoya, and those are still in the experimental mode. But we do have an option of orthokeratology. We do have an option of bifocal contact lenses. It should be considered. Even the management with the progressive addition lens should be considered as to form normal emmetropization process. The point I have mentioned here is about RGP and soft contact lens. It is compared to the spectacle lenses, the RGP and soft contact lens does better to have an image cell near to the retina. So with this, I conclude my presentation. So if you have any questions to ask, you can surely ask me. I hope you were able to get what I wanted to say there.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Shall I stop sharing the presentation now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, student, if you have any question, so you can ask. If you have any query, please ask to sir. Yes, sir. Sir, I have one question. Can I ask,
please.
Sir?
Yes, sure.
Yes, sir. So here I have seen so many studies. The most of the studies are for foreign studies. Is there any Indian studies? Are there Indian students or Indian researcher doing about for myopia study or going on in India?
What I understand is like there are various studies which are currently going on, and even many public health policies are going on. So as to consider these, the factors what we were saying is about the level of dopamine. So considering the foreign scenario, there is little evidence as far as my knowledge is concerned about the emetropization during the this one, emetropization among the Indian population. Even actually, in fact, I wanted to get some studies so as to compare. However, there was little studies which were among the Indian population. Mostly it is focusing on Asian population. But there are many studies which are currently going on with the different organizations. And for sure, in near future, we will be getting it the data from the Indian community as well. And even there are public health policies which are thought to be implemented, such as increasing the outdoor activities among school children. That would also be useful in reducing the burden of myopia. But for sure, there are many studies which are stating the increased prevalence of myopia among the children as well as the Indian population.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, another question from my side, sir. Is there any study about atropinization therapy?
Yeah, correct.
Is there any study from India?
Not from India, I would say, but there are studies which are done related to with atropine, and this atropine they have used initially they used it with the different dosages, that is 1%, but considering the side effect, the atropine dosage they reduced by 0.5, and they are also trying to reduce the concentration of it, and they try to understand that how much is the change in like myopia control? Is it same with the high dosage and with the low dosage? Because ultimately with atropine, we know that there are side effects. And those side effects to avoid, such as photophobia is one of the side effects. Lack of accommodation is a side effect. So to avoid this, they are trying to reduce the concentration and try to see the effect of atropine with the lower concentration, and they are getting a positive result. That is, it is almost similar to that of the high dosage of atropine. So yes, those are effective. And even there are certain drugs which are also acting or antagonist to this muscarinic receptors and also preventing the progression of myopia. So those are still the positive indications for the myopia prevention. So hopefully later on in future, we'll be getting those available with us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. It was a very informative session, sir. So now I request to Mr. Rakesh, sir, our HOD department. So please vote of thanks.
Hello. Yes, sir. I'm here. Thank you so much, sir, for such a detailed informative talk on early refractive development. I'm really, actually, we are really thankful to you for the talk, for taking your time for this session. And what we have found, the content of the talk was fully research-based, which was quite informative and, you know, it was impressive too. So thank you so much for being associated with the Department of Optometry, Tirthankar Mahavir University. Thank you all the participants for joining with us. And again, thank you so much, Gopi sir, for your talk, for your informative talk. Thank you so much.
No, you are most welcome. And it is also my interest. So it is actually even thank you to you as well as Nauri sir, as well as Pinaki sir, that it is always good to interact with all of us so that we extend our knowledge further. And yes, definitely this myopia or emmetropization is our core, optometric core. So I have much interest in it. And good to see all the students here. So, but I don't know who is from master's, who is from bachelor's. And
sir, actually, there's students from bachelor second semester, fourth semester, sixth semester, master second semester, and fourth semester. The students are from these different UG and PG students are there. Even the diploma students are also joined the system.
Okay, great. Yeah. So even they might be doing research on myopia, or I would like to understand from their perspective as well. What are the
research? Sure, sir. We are expecting more and more lectures from you in future too.
Yes, sure. Definitely.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.